Hariyom, are you all able to hear clearly?
Hariyom Swamiji, yes, can he hear and see also?
Okay, because I am at a different place, so internet, I am not sure how it is. Sorry for the delay. We trying to set up this arrangement here for the session. It took some time. So we were on mantra number 15, where Nachiketa has asked Lord Yamraj in the earlier mantra that what is that which is beyond dharma and adharma, beyond cause and effect, beyond past and future. Please tell me that which you experience. Yat tat pashyasi tad vada. That was mantra 14. So as a reply to that, Yamraj starts explaining. And he says here, 15th one, Sarve Veda yat padam amananti. All the Vedas, the state which they describe, the essence of the entire Vedic knowledge, tapamsi sarvani cha yad vadanti, and tapas, those who do tapasya, the purpose for which they do the tapasya, and desiring to reach that state, they follow brahmacharya also. Brahmacharyam charanti. Tatte padam sangrahena bravimi. That state I will explain to you. Om ityeta. That is Om. So now Yamraj is explaining what he experiences. And this is an answer to all those three aspects. And this is the answer to the earlier question also. The third boon of Nachiketa was asti iti eke na ayam asti iti cheke. Some people say it exists, some people say it is of the nature of non-existence. What is that ultimate state? So that ultimate state is Om, and then the elaboration of Om will come now. So now let us see what the commentary says. Sarve Veda yat padam, padaniyam gamaniyam avibhagena amananti pratipadayanti. Meaning that state which is the goal, which is to be discovered. Gamaniyam. Meaning that is what we must discover, aspire to be. Avibhagena. Without any differences, meaning in a homogeneous way, in a same way, uncontradictory way, all the Vedas explain that state. See, four Vedas, each of them will speak about Om, but there is no contradiction in that. So avibhagena, amananti pratipadayanti, they explain. Tapamsi sarvani cha yad vadanti. All the tapas is meant to experience this state. Whether one does puja, japa, vrata, upvas, anything, maun vrata, any such tapas is meant to discover this supreme state. Yat praptyarthan iti arthaha. Yadichanto brahmacharyam gurukula vasa lakshanam. One meaning of brahmacharya is to go to a guru, stay there, and follow the discipline there, dedicate oneself fully to the study and service. So people go away from their home, they stay in the Gurukul for a long period of time, serving the teacher there, studying, doing the sadhana. For what? For experiencing this state. Or brahmacharya means brahma praptyartham charanti. Take up any sadhana, brahma praptyartham charanti. Take up any sadhana that will lead to realization of Brahman. So that state which the seekers use, which the seekers want to attain, by either staying in Gurukul or taking up any sadhana which leads them to Brahman, tat te tubhyam padam yajnyatum ichasi sangrahena sankshepata bravimi. What you want to know, I am going to indicate that to you, which is this state. What is that? Om ityetat. That state is called as Om. So it's not a state of non-existence. It is a positive state, desiring which people do all the tapasya. They take up sadhanas to experience Brahman. They go out of their home comfort and they stay in Gurukul. And they do all this tapasya and sadhana so that they experience this state. So Yamaraj says, I am explaining that state to you. What is that state? Om ityetat. What is this Om? Tadetat padam yad bhubhutsitam tvaya. He will explain what is Om, but he says, this is the state that you want to know. Yadetat Om ityetat. Om Shabda Vachyam, Om Shabda Pratikamcha. So this Om is a very unique symbol. Om is the goal also and Om is the means also. Shabda Vachyam means the state indicated by that Om, meaning consciousness. And Shabda Pratikam means Om itself is a means to quieten the mind, meditate and realize that state. So Om is both. Is Shabda Vachyam, Shabda Pratikam. Ultimate goal and the means towards that also. So different sadhanas are taken up. All those sadhanas can be summarized as do the Omkar Upasana, you will discover that state. So Om as a goal is that state of pure consciousness, Brahman. And how to discover that? Through Om itself. Do Omkar Upasana. Chant the mantra Om, meditate on the significance of this Om. So that will come next. That's the next part of it. But this is what it is, that the answer Nachiketa is given is this. Before Yamaraj goes on to explain the nature of Atma, here it is that Yamaraj is explaining about Om, so that the student also is very clear, as well as the student has a support, alamban. So that will come now, because thinking of Brahman absolute may not be easy for everybody. So some support has to be given, and that support can help the student to purify the mind, make it single pointed, subtle, sharp, etc. And here it is the Omkar Upasana. So Omkar can be used for Upasana to purify and prepare oneself, or Omkar can be used as a direct pointer to Brahman, that state, and one contemplates on it. So either ways one can use it. And for each one the result is also different. So the next mantra goes on to tell us that what is the result. Etad Hevaksharam Brahma, Etad Hevaksharam Param, Etad Hevaksharam Jnatva, Yoya Dichasitasyatat. He says, Etad Hi Eva Aksharam Brahma. This Akshara, Om is Akshara. Ekakshara Brahma it is called. It is one syllable indicating the Supreme. Etadhi eva aksharam brahma. Etadhi eva aksharam param. So this Brahman here, I will come to explain that. It's called lower Brahman, Saguna Brahman. And Param indicates the supreme Brahman, formless, nameless, attributeless. So Brahman is also of. So Brahman, it doesn't have two levels, two categories, but Brahman is indicated in two ways. One is absolute, nameless, formless, attributeless, pure consciousness. That is the supreme. That is indicated here by the word param. And what is this other Brahman? Eta devaksharam brahma. The word brahma here is not the supreme, nameless, formless attribute, because that is indicated by param. The word brahma here is that sagun brahman, or we call it as Hiranyagarbha. If you see Gurudev's commentary on this particular verse, there is a footnote there in that commentary. Here Brahman means lower or Saguna Brahman, and the higher means Nirguna Brahman. So Saguna Brahman is when we take a support, and Nirguna Brahman is nameless, formless, attributeless truth. So Saguna Brahman is like the Omkar. So Omkar indicates the Saguna Brahman, which what we just spoke is the means to purify the mind, Saguna Brahman. Nirguna Brahman is the Nididhyasana on the pure consciousness. That is the goal. One becomes one with that supreme state. So Omkar is both. Eta Devaksharam Jnatva Yoya Dichasi Tasyata. Knowing this Aksharam, whatever one desires, that will be fulfilled. Meaning, what one aspires to be, how one uses that support symbol. So how uses that symbol of Om. If one uses Om for upasana, for purifying, then it will purify. If one uses Om for nididhyasan, one will become one with the state of pure consciousness. So depends on what attitude I have, what type of sadhana I do, that particular result one will get. Yo yad ichyasi tasya tat. So let us see what he says here. Eta dhyevaksharam brahma aparam eta dhyevaksharam param cha. So see, apara and para, higher and lower. Aparam is lower, param is higher. So saguna brahman, the brahman which with form is considered lower to brahman without form, because one is a means, the other is the goal. So when we say aparam, does not mean it is lower in the sense it is something that is not to be used or something that is condemnable. It is not like that. It is depending on the purity of the mind, the subtlety of the mind. If the mind is not capable of meditating or contemplating on formless, nameless, attributeless truth, then one should take the support and make the mind single-pointed, pure. Otherwise, one will neither be there nor here. Which is what happens to so many people. When we come to Vedant, then we say, no, 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 we will not do Murti Puja. I don't believe in all this. I'll just meditate on consciousness. But the mind is not ready. It doesn't have that much of vairagya, sense control, equanimity. In the Gita, Bhagavan says that those who are identified with the body, if they try to contemplate on the truth with such strong body identification and jiva bhav, what will happen? Klesho adhikataras tesham avyakta satta chetasam. They have lot of disturbance, klesha, their mind will not abide. It will wander all over. Avyakta hi gatir dukham. They will experience misery and sorrow. Dehavadbhira vapyate. They are attached to the body. What are the qualifications required to contemplate on the formless? Sanniyamya indriya gramam. Sarvatra. Controlling all the senses. Samabuddhaya. So all the senses must be controlled. At all times I must be equanimous. Sarvatra samabuddhaya. Ke prapnuvanti mam eva. They will attain me who sarvabhuta hite rataha, engaged in service of all the beings, doesn't have any raga or dvesha. So now these are three qualifications required to contemplate on Brahman. So this person who says that, you know, I believe only in formless, I don't do idol worship, I don't want any support, reject form, reject scripture, reject God, reject Guru, all that. Are the three qualifications there? Are my senses fully controlled? Do I have equanimity of mind? Do I serve the people with the bhav of Bhagwan is in all of them? If I have that, then I am ready for contemplation on the formless absolute truth. If I don't have that, then I must use the form. Now this Omkar Upasana is actually, when it is said Apara Brahma, compared to nameless, formless, attributeless, pure consciousness, this is one notch below. But actually, if you remember, we have discussed earlier that this Upasanas in our culture, they are in three levels. One is Saguna and Sakar. The Lord who has a form and who has qualities. Saguna and Sakar. Like Krishna, Shiva, Ganesh, Devi, Durga. These are forms. Proper physical human forms and attributes also. Because an emotional bond has to be connected, then the surrender happens. And the Lord manifests as these forms. So don't think that these are created by human beings. Some people think you are created by human beings. No, these forms exist. So many saints have had darshan of these forms. And so that is one first level. Somebody's mind is more evolved. They don't need a physical form. They use a subtle sound symbol. So Omkar is a sound symbol. See, Omkar does not, Om does not have a form. This Om, how we write, no? That form is created by somebody. It is not there in the Veda. They call Om only as Akshara Brahma, Nada Brahma. It is a sound symbol. So there is no form. So it is Saguna Niraka, no form, but qualities are there. Why? Because it is representing Ishvara only, it is representing consciousness only. And as long as I use it as a support, as a means, then it is not Brahman, attributeless, formless, nameless. It is totality, Ishvara. But through sound we are connecting. So what do we say? Just using Om, our bhav is I am connecting to that Ishvara who has qualities, is all pervasive, kind, compassionate, all powerful, omniscient, all that. So Sagun Nirakar, Sagun Sakar level 1, Sagun Nirakar level 2. And if I am much more purified, then Nirgun Nirakar is level 3, where using pointers of Brahman, one loses the ego, discovers oneness with the Supreme. So now that is called Supreme Brahman, Param Brahma, which also is indicated only by Nirgun Nirakar. Please remember that. It is not that the words are that state. No, no, no. The supreme state of Brahman, nameless, formless, attributeless, is not described by any words. All words are pointers. So if the mind is ready, then Omkar Upasana is done at both these levels. Either Sagun Nirakar as a symbol to quieten the mind, or as Nirgun Nirakar indicating that state of Brahman. Which is what he says here. That Etadhyevaksharam Brahma, which means the Sagun Nirakar Upasana. And Etadhyevaksharam Param. And this is also indicating that supreme state itself, not the means to purify. So Shankaracharya ji says, Tayori Pratikam Etadaksharam Pratikam. Pratikam means support. So one is a support. Etadhyeva Aksharam Jnatva Upasya Brahma Iti Yo Yadichasi Param Aparam Bhat Tasya Tad Bhavati. If one thinks of it as Aparam, Apara Brahma, does the Upasana to quieten the mind, then that is the result. if one does the contemplation saying, no, this is a supreme state, and one meditates on that as one's own self, then one will get that result. That's how he says, yo yad icchati param aparam va tasya tad bhavati. So that's why the importance of bhavana, importance of the outlook, when we use the symbols. Even when we do mantra, this applies to all upasanas in that sense. Suppose one says Om Namah Shivaya. Now Om Namah Shivaya, if one does the japa with the bhav that I salute or surrender to Lord Shiva, and keeping that form in mind, then one meditates or does the japa, the result one will get is the purity of mind as well as maybe darshan of the Lord Shiva in that form. But if I say Om Namah Shivaya, and I say ki I am one with that pure consciousness who is Shiva, who is auspiciousness by nature, then the result is the state of realization. So the mantra Om Namah Shivaya is a means also and is indicating the goal also. So with what attitude am I sitting and using that mantra? That is important to know. Mechanically chanting, sometimes we begin with that. But as we move in spiritual path, we must become more conscious. What is the attitude? What is the bhavana? How am I using this mantra? What is my objective? Accordingly, the whole bhavana, accordingly, the whole result will happen. Especially the student of Vedanta must be conscious of all that. It's not just somehow just take the name of the Lord. By itself, name of the Lord will purify, no doubt. But that purified mind only is brought to satsang and the knowledge is revealed and that person comes to know, I can use like this. Then one has to apply that. So it applies to all mantras. Here it is using Om. And when I say all mantras, it doesn't mean every single mantra. Mantras meant for this. There are rajasic, tamasic mantras also, which are meant for power, pleasure, prestige, all that. I am not talking about those. Sadhana mantras for realization. Those mantras can be used for making the mind pure. That's us, Apara Brahma. Or meditate on it as the pure consciousness. Then that is Parabrahma. Now one very interesting line it is here. Param chet jnatavyam, aparam chet praptavyam. For Vedantic students, this is an important line, and most Vedantic discussions, arguments, etc., somewhere or the other this line gets quoted on the topic of Brahman. Param chet jnatavyam. If it is supreme state, then it has to be only known, because it already exists, is infinite, no? It pure consciousness, infinite, so it exists. What Nachiketa asked, no? What is beyond past and future? Meaning it is eternal, it is timeless. So if it is timeless, it exists even now. It is not absent. But I am not experiencing it. If it exists even now and I'm not experiencing it, that's only because of my ignorance of its existence and its nature. So the solution in that case is only knowledge, jnatavyam. That ignorance is removed by knowledge. Gurudev used to give that famous example of, this mala is on the neck. I don't know if the mala is already on my neck and I'm searching everywhere. Somebody only has to point out to me and I must just get the knowledge ki, this mala is already here. I don't have to do anything to wear it, to get it, to procure it, nothing, because it already exists. But if it is not there with me, then I have to get. So aparam chet praptavyam. Right now I am identified with the jiva bhava, so I am not attained a state of purity. Now that with effort has to be attained. But Brahman, which is my true nature, is already existing, is my nature even now. I just don't know it. So praptavya is what is not attained. Gnatavya is what is already attained. So Guruji gives an equation saying that for experiencing what already is, knowledge alone is enough. That is called praptasya prapti. What is already attained, but I am not aware of it. Then I just need to become aware of it. So praptasya prapti is only through knowledge. But what is not attained, with that requires effort to attain it. So apraptasya prapti requires knowledge plus action. I need to do some karma. I need knowledge of what I don't have. I need knowledge of how to get that. And then using that knowledge, I have to do some karma. And then I will get that result. But that result will be apara. It will be temporary. It will not be permanent. Because whatever is done, whatever is born as a result of action, that will not be permanent. That will be temporary only. So what is praptavya will always be temporary. But what is gnatavya, what is to be known, that which is infinite, that is already existing now also. Someone may say, but no, you are doing Shravan Mana Nididhyasana also to gain that. So you are doing action for that. This knowledge is different. The sadhana of Shravan Mana Nididhyasana is not for getting Brahman. It is for removing the obstacle. To remove ignorance, to remove the doubt, samshaya, the Shravan Manan Nididhyasana is done. False identification, doubts, ignorance, these are removed by the sadhana. The sadhana doesn't produce anything. In the earlier case, the sadhana produces something which is finite, so it will remain in time and it will get perished. But this is not to produce. So gnatavya, one should not think of it as an intellectual knowledge and then the self is produced. Self is not produced by Shravan Mana Nididhyasana. Obstacles to that realization are ignorance, doubt, false identification. Those are removed. And what will be experienced is that which is already mine right now. Like when somebody tells me that the mala is already on your neck, the ignorance of mind that the mala is here, that goes away. That knowledge is not producing the mala. The mala is already self-existent here. That knowledge is only removing my ignorance of its location, of its nature. Where is it? What is it? I didn't know. Then one says, Swamiji, that is a Rudraksha mala on your neck. Oh. Immediate realization. In that way it is this. Praptavyam param chet jnatavyam aparam chet praptavyam. Whatever is prapta is apara. Whatever is existing already is para. Because that is infinite. And hence in our culture we say even darshan of Bhagwan is one level below absorption in the absolute truth. Because by effort one has got Chitta Shuddhi, which makes the darshan of the Lord possible. But that will disappear for however long it may be that one has the darshan of Bhagwan. It will disappear because Bhagwan will vanish in that form. And the Jiva also will again want to have the darshan. So what will Bhagwan do? Ultimately, Bhagwan takes that Jiva to the Swarup and makes the Jiva realize, here you and I are one in our essential nature. That is Gnatavya. That is not Praptavya. Once that state is experienced by the devotee, is known, kyare, I am one with Brahman, then no more one falls into the level of body identification. But the other state of purity of mind can come and go. So one has to hold on to that strongly, uncompromisingly, and then from there contemplate on the truth, realize. That's the method. So Omkar can be used as an alamban for praptavyam, for experiencing what I don't have right now, purity of mind, single-pointedness, as an alamban. And then with that pure mind, contemplate on Om as the state of consciousness, which is Parabrahma, which is only Gnatavya, which is not Praptavya. The supreme state is not Praptavya. It is Gnatavya. It's only to be recognized, known as one's own self. So what Nachiketa had asked, this is the answer to that. Tell me about that state which is beyond dharma and adharma. So this, by saying Omkar is that which is a supreme state, that supreme state is beyond dharma and adharma. By saying that Omkar is that which is absolute state, the answer is given. It is beyond past and future. And it's that absolute state from which nothing has come out. It is neither cause nor effect. That will come in the later mantra. Cause and effect part will come in the later mantra. But one, because one may suddenly wonder why this Omkar is coming here now, what question Nachiketa asked and what Yamaraj is answering. It seems there is no connection. But this is the connection. That Omkar is that state, knowing which these two aspects that Nachiketa asked, that is answered. That it is beyond past and future, beyond dharma and adharma. Because dharma and adharma are at the intellect level. And past and future is because of time. And when the mind is functioning, time is experienced. This is beyond mind, so beyond time. And this is again beyond mind, hence no dharma and no adharma here. The supreme state of Om. Now he elaborates a little further the same thing. Etadalambanam shreshtham, etadalambanam param, etadalambanam jnatva, brahma loke mahiyate. So he says this alamban is shreshtha, thus the most powerful alamban is Om. And it is supreme also, alambanam param. And having known this as alamban, a person can reach even up to Brahmalok. Omkar upasana, if it doesn't, so if the mind is not yet ready to experience the absolute truth while living here and now, and the body drops, then what will this lead to? Brahmaloka. Brahmaloke mahiyate. Let us see what he says here. Etad alambanam, etad brahma, prapti alambananam shreshtam, prashasya tamam. See, this Omkar is very, very subtle alamban. As we said, you know, it doesn't have a form, no human form. So you cannot build a human relationship. In the sense that how we have, okay, Krishna is my friend, Krishna is my master, Krishna is my son. You know, each devotee has a bhav. Sudama had Sakhya bhav, friend. Yashoda had the Matra bhav. So the child is my, the Lord is my mother, my child. Kali Ma is my mother. So Ramakrishna had that bhav. So now human form and human emotion and human relation is one type of support. Alamban. This is subtlest alamban. No human support, no human form, no human emotion, only sound. And though the Lord is Sagun Nirakar, but to connect to that Supreme Lord, I am using only sound. So no form. So if our mind, when we meditate on Om, if the mind focuses on only the sound and no image is there in front, then that is okay. But if my mind is meditating on sound, but the mind is having images of worldly things, then I am not ready for Omkar Upasana. Then better to keep the form of Om, which actually has no form, but then someone has given that form as Om, then at least use that. Better still would be to come to the level of Sagun Sakar Upasana, identify a human form, surrender the emotion and the ego, and build a relationship with that Lord. So this Omkar Upasana, not everybody is ready for it. And that's why if you see in the earlier tradition, they would say that not everybody has the adhikara to chant Om. See, that is not a justification in the name of exploitation, or to say that, you know, only Brahmins can chant Om and nobody else can chant Om. That is not what it is meant. It is like saying that if a student of fifth standard sits in a quantum physics class, he is not eligible, can't understand anything because he's not laid proper foundation. So when he said etadalambanam shrestham prashasyatamam, it is most praiseworthy because it is the subtlest sound symbol. Even from the Vedic standpoint, if you see, the entire essence of the Veda is in the 24 syllables of Gayatri Mantra. 24 syllables of Gayatri Mantra, the essence is in the three Vyahritis, Bhuhu, Bhuva, Suvaha. And the essence of these three Vyahritis is in Om. So hence, it is the subtlest, most powerful mantra itself. That's why it's the most powerful symbol. Etad alambanam shrestham. There's nothing great, no alamban greater than this Om. Etad alambanam shrestham. So what does it mean that if I am chanting Om, I should not take it for granted. I should do it with that bhav that I am taking this, I am pronouncing the supreme sound symbol of Bhagwan, of the creator or Brahman, whatever we call it. With that bhav, if I take, it will purify the mind. Otherwise, I can just say Om, 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 Om. No bhav, no understanding, no feeling that, array, I am using the name of the supreme sound symbol of the Lord. And in that sound symbol is included the whole creation also. Because A, U and Ma are the three alphabets which combine to form this sound, Om. All human language fits within this A, U and Ma. All sound possibilities fit within A, U and Ma. A starts at the Nabhi, U and Ma. So the whole range of sound, even in the throat, is all covered, sound possibilities are covered in A, U and Ma. This whole universe also is sound vibrations. So this Omkar helps us to connect with the Supreme Lord when we withdraw the senses also and connect to the Lord using just the sound. And when we are living in the world outside, this Omkar only is all this. In the Taittiriya Upanishad, it is said, Om iti idagam sarvam. Om is all this. Because the source from where all this came is that Brahman. And Omkar is indicating that Brahman. As vibrations also, Om pervades the whole universe. As Brahman also, Om pervades the whole universe. Hence, this is a symbol which is most unique, most powerful, most subtle, and one should prepare oneself properly with the right bhav, right attitude. Then the benefit is maximum. So that is what it says. Om alambananam shrestham prashasya tamam. Etad alambanam param aparam cha. Para apara brahma vishayatva. And what we discussed, it is both para and apara brahma, indicates both. Depends on which type of bhav we have and what type of upasana we do. Etad alambanam jnatva brahma loke mahiyate. Parasmin brahmani. Now you see, brahma loke mahiyate has two meanings. Brahma rupi loke mahiyate. Meaning, if I contemplate on this Brahman using Omkar and I am able to let go of the ego completely, here and now I experience Brahman, that is Jivan Mukti. Because loka means a field of experience. Loka doesn't mean some physical place only. So here and now one experiences that oneness with Brahman. Brahma loke mahiyate. Mahiyate means enjoy. Brahma loke. In that state of Brahman, one will revel in that state of Brahman. So Omkar Upasana can lead to Jivan Mukti. And the second meaning is, if I don't realize it here and now, and I drop the body, then this Omkar will lead me to Brahma Lok, the highest Lok, where Brahmaji is there and the Sadhak lives there in contemplation on Brahman, because there is no desire to come back to earth for some enjoyments. One wants only that state. There, Brahmaji and the Sadhak, they both are there. When the Kalpa is to be, when the dissolution has to happen, Brahmaji only gives the knowledge to the Jiva there and the Jiva realizes before the Kalpa dissolves. So that is called Krama Mukti. So when it is said Brahma Loke Mahiyate, that's what it means. That jnatva brahma loke mahiyate parasmin brahmani aparasmin cha brahma bhuto brahmavat upasyo bhavati ityarthaha. So that's what it is. Aparasmin brahma bhuto brahmavat upasyo bhavati. One will become worshipful like Brahman also. Because high state of realization, high state of evolution, Vairagya, Vivek, etc. No desire. So one goes to Brahmalok, waits there, gets the knowledge and Brahmaji releases. But in the world also that person becomes worshipful. That such a great Vairagi he was, dispassionate person and single pointed on attaining, single pointed for realizing the truth. So that is the meaning of this. Now, when both these are told, actually for Nachiketa, this much is enough to understand ki what is that state. Pure consciousness is that state. Now that will get elaborated, but because Upanishad doesn't leave anything for somebody's imagination. So what is that state that Yamaraj is seeing that Nachiketa asked him to tell? So Nachiketa, when he asked that question, Yamaraj says that state is Om. And then he gives both. For Nachiketa, the Alamban is not required for Upasana to purify the mind. For Nachiketa, it is only contemplate on that and realize the truth. Now what is the nature of that Omka or that state, your consciousness? That is the nature of Atma. That is what is indicated next. So this connecting passage between this mantra and the next one is Anyatra Dharma, Anyatra Dharmadi Ityadina Prishtasya Atmanaha Ashesha Vishesha Rahitasya Alambanatvena Pratikatvena Cha Omkaro Nirdishtaha. So he says, what is asked earlier by Anyatra Dharma, that mantra? Nachiketa has asked about Atma, which is free from all distinctions. Ashesha Vishesha Rahitasya. All distinctions. And those who are Manda Adhikari and Madhyam Adhikari, for them it is, Yamaraj spoke about Omkar as the state of pure consciousness. For the Uttam Adhikari, what is that state? Ashesha and Vishesha Rahita. So that is the state. But if I am not ready for that state, then Alambana Tvena Pratika Tvena. Then it is shown as an Alamban. So depending on the Adhikara, Yamaraj has explained about that state as the non-differentiating, attributeless, pure consciousness. That is indicated by Om. And if I am not ready for it, then it is indicated as Alamban, as a support. Aparasyaja Brahmano Mandama Madhya Pratipatrun Prati. Yes, towards Manda and Madhyam. Atha idanin tasya omkara alambanasya atmanah sakshatkara sakshat swarupa nirdidharishaya. Atmanah sakshat swarupad swarupa nirdidharishaya. Now, what is the nature of the Atma, which was indicated as attributeless? Some more pointers about that Atma, Swarup, are given now. So that is the next mantra. So this is one famous mantra, which is there even in the Gita as it is lifted by Vedavyasji. Najayate mriyate va vipaschita. Nayam kutaschinna babhuva kaschita ajo nityam shashvato yam purano na hanyate hanyamane sharire. So what is the nature of this Atma? See, this mantra is a very important and powerful one. So if possible, one should memorize this. Na jayate, Atma is that which is not born. Na mriyate, it will not die. Na jayate mriyate va vipaschit. Vipaschit means what? You see, here Gurudev in his commentary has explained very nicely this word vipaschit. Fourth paragraph in his commentary, Gurudev has said here, we must note here that the word vipaschit is used for Atman. And it is no accidental usage or meaning blown into it due to the circumstances. It comes from the root vip, to quiver or tremble. Hence its adjective vip inspired, its noun vipas, inspiration. So vipaschit, knowing inspiration, born of the experience of the pure knowledge. It is an indicator of Atma. Na jayate mriyate va vipaschit. This Atma is neither born nor it dies. It is of the nature of pure knowledge, inspiration. Nayam kutaschin na babhuva kaschit. Neither it is a cause nor is it an effect. Meaning nothing is born. So it is not born and nothing is born out of it. Remember what Nachiketa has asked. Tell me that which is beyond Krita and Akrita, beyond cause and effect. So it is Atma is that which is beyond cause and effect. Nayam Krutaschin, na Babhuva Kaschin. Ajo Nitya Shashvatoyam Purana. It is unborn, Ajaha, Nitya, eternal, Shashvata, permanent, Purana, most ancient. And na Hanyate Hanyamane Sharire. Now this is the main line. It does not get destroyed even when the body is destroyed. So now Nachiketa in the third boon had asked, is that a state of blank or is it an existing state? When one transcends the body identification, what is the nature of that? What is that state? He says it is a state of Atma, which is unborn, eternal, immortal, unchanging, most ancient, and it does not get destroyed when the body dies. Meaning it is not of the nature of non-existence. So that's the clear answer that Nachiketa has been given here. More about this mantra we will take up in our next session. If you have Gurudev's commentary, please read the commentary on the verses that we have done today as well as this, the last one that we did, a very beautiful commentary. Any questions anybody has, you are welcome to ask. Okay.
Hari Om Swamiji.
Yeah, Hari Om, tell me.
Hello, Hari Om. Why these verses are repeated in every Upanishads or the Gita? What is the symbolism for that?
No symbolism. Not everybody will read all Upanishads. No, not everybody reads the each Upanishad. Gita is more easy and practically applicable for people. So then when they are given in the Gita, people get the same, number one, the knowledge. Number two, we know that the Gita is the essence of the Upanishad. Sarva Upanishado Gavo Dogdha Gopala Nandana. So being the essence of the Upanishad, some of these important verses are directly lifted by Vedavyasji and put there in the Gita. It's just to make it more convenient and easy for the seeker. There's no other reason for that. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om.